Hey, before we get started, can everybody hear me? Good evening.
Yes.
Can we ask you guys to move to the middle? It's a lot easier for the panelists if they can just sort of make eye contact or have to go all the way to the far left.
And we have a prize for those who sit in the middle. We'll be eligible for that. We're serious. We have a few books to give away.
Wow, thanks.
Sam, you can always count on Sam to pull something like that out of
the I have it. Book is not shipped yet, but we won't get to you. No, it's in the mail right now. We prepare for that.
Okay, good evening, everybody. We are delighted that you could be here to join us. First, we're having a little bit of trouble with the sound, so Laura, if you can hear me. Nod your head, and you already did, so thank you. My name is Vijay Gorbaksani. I'm the director of the Center for Digital Transformation, and we are just delighted that you could be here this evening. First question, how many of you have been to this building before? None. So isn't this amazing? So if you look next door, that was our old building, and we are all just delighted that we actually, after 20 years, have some decent office space. We're not doing events at Cal IT2 anymore. This is our first center event here. Working a lot more difficult, but the venue's a lot nicer, so that's the trade-off we had to deal with. Moving along, so, you know, we launched the center 3 years ago, and, you know, we've really sort of made a lot of progress with your support and your enthusiasm, so we're delighted that all of you continue to support us with the energy that you do. I do want to say a couple of things. One, we have some really interesting programming that is upcoming. So on December 8th, we have another idea exchange in healthcare, and Sam will talk to you more about that if you watch the slides behind me. We're cycling through the slides as well. What we're really excited about is our annual signature conference. We did the first one in March of 2015. We're doing another one in March of 2016. And we've really lined up a who's who of speakers and to speak at that conference. And the idea is, how do we help businesses reinvent for a digital age? So we're looking forward to seeing many of you at that event as well. And finally, we're launching a big data and analytics program. It's a certificate program. It's on October 23rd and 24th, if I get that correctly. Those dates are up there as well. And you know, with the big push on analytics, that is something that we believe a lot of people need some refreshing of skills and maybe even the acquisition of new skills. So we would be delighted if some of you would join us for that. And a lot of this information is on our website. But without further ado, so you know, I left the analytics program for last because that's a lot of what we're going to talk about today as well. So we're delighted that we have an amazing panel. I'm not going to introduce them formally. I'm going to save that for Sam King. But I would like to say thank you all for coming. It has been a while since we've done an event. And you know, we had one scheduled that was canceled for unforeseeable circumstances, which is the one that's rescheduled on December 8th. So again, thank you for continuing to support us. This program has been, you know, the person who's handling our digital healthcare events is Sam King, and most of you probably know Sam King. And Sam brings an incredible energy and thought about kind of the kinds of programs we should put forward in digital healthcare. And so we are very grateful to Sam, and with that, Sam, thank you for everything that you do for us, and of course the team of the digital transformation that puts all these events on. And we're looking forward to feedback from you. Tell us what we can do better. We'll only get better if you share that kind of information with us. And then my personal thanks to the panelists, you know, from UCI, Chalk, Children's Hospital in LA, SAP, and SAS. And one of them is actually, sorry, SAP's not here today because he pulled out at last minute. But again, thank you all for sharing your expertise with us. You know, what we're really trying to do is make the practice of healthcare better. And to the extent that we can diffuse knowledge in the way that universities can, we're very happy to play our little role in making healthcare better. So thank you all for coming. Thank you to our special guests. And with that, Sam, thank you so much for all that you do.
Thank you very much, Vijay. Welcome, everyone. Mine's very short. How many people have been to this digital healthcare exchange program here? We've got a lot of opportunities here. I think gotta come more often, give us our feedback, and make this program worthwhile even. On my way here, I heard NPR talking about Gartner coined a new term called small data just today. So we'll talk about, that was a joke. Anyway, you almost fell for it. But big data is amazing. We have amazing panelists here today, and Chuck Podesta, CIO of UCI Healthcare will be introduced them after the movie. This movie, reached out to the producer of this movie, Sandy. Unfortunately, he's busy shooting a next project, so he sent requests. Otherwise, will be another dimension added to this big data and analytics. I want to make sure that everybody enjoys that. There's a feedback sheets on your chair, making sure you provide that feedback to us, because your feedback counts, really. That's what really means here. You may see some names on these, on those chairs. Making sure if you don't see name, maybe your name should be there. I'm not responsible for that. I'm just saying, hey, I'm a graduate of UCI, love UCI. Those are the opportunities as well, okay? Without further ado, we're going to start program very soon then. After that, I'm going to bring Chuck Podesta, CIO of UCI Healthcare, up to stage when the panelists will set up, introduce themselves. The format is very simple today. It's a dialogue. Okay? And Chuck will talk more about that. So, Debbie, you want to guess the movie? The movie is about 15 minutes long. Okay? Popcorn will be served if you request in advance. Maybe Coke or something, I don't know. Those logistics will be handled by wonderful staff here. So enjoy the movie and we'll start with the discussion. Okay. Thank you very much. Finally, paraphrase one of the narrative words. I'm fundamentally optimistic that big data analytics will transform healthcare, which is perfect segue for Chuck Vessel to bring the panels. Chuck, I don't know if anybody knows Chuck well, but I would like to introduce one fact. Chuck, if anybody wants to run a marathon, try to compete with this CIO. He's a marathon CIO. Unbelievable. How many races you won? In Boston, Paris?
Boston, Chicago.
Chicago.
London next year, New York, and fall.
Unbelievable. So, without further ado, Chuck, please.
Thank you. Yeah, everybody hear me okay?
Sure.
All right, come on up, Bill. We'll get started here. This is simple as possible. So, as you can see, we're not going to talk about data warehouses and data mapping and all that cool kind of stuff. I'm Chuck Podesta, the Chief Information Officer for University of California, Irvine Health. And happy to be here. I'm happy you guys took time out of your evening to come here. Hopefully you get a lot out of what we're going to talk about tonight. I'm going to keep this pretty flexible from a moderator standpoint. I'm going to talk briefly a little bit about what we're doing at UCI, just to give you a flavor for some of the stuff that actually was part of what you saw up here in a very small way, and then introduce, have the panelists introduce themselves, and I'll fire off the first question to them, and then we'll go from there. I want to open up to the audience as quickly as possible because this is your panel, not my panel, so I want you to get engaged as quickly as possible. But one of the things I think you saw in the video was that really what we're talking about building here is not a data warehouse. We're talking about building a living, breathing ecosystem. And I think within healthcare, that's where we need to go. We are very, very early stages of that. Other industries are very much far ahead of us. A colleague of mine who works in the insurance industry was telling me about some interesting things that they're doing where if you call up a particular company for an insurance policy, while you're on the phone, they are mining you. They're creating a persona of you during that conversation. And they're basically identifying a policy that meets your needs based on that conversation. Not based on your actual need, it's based on your ability to pay. Depending on if you were an individual that makes $35,000 a year, you call with pretty much the same conversation that somebody was making $200,000 a year, you could potentially get the same policy, but a very different price point. Okay, so it's very interesting as to how certain industries are using the data that you all are creating. One of the things that we're doing at UCI right now, we have a big Hadoop database, and we take physiological monitor information once every minute from all the monitors within UCI Health. It's a very, very powerful, lots of data. We've been doing it for a couple of years now. So we're actually starting to come back, working with some clinicians, go back in time and start looking at patients that have crashed at some point, you know, during their stay at UC Health, and looking at, you know, what happened to them, you know, an hour before they crashed, what happened to them 30 minutes before they crashed, what happened to them 15 minutes before they crashed, and looking at that physiological data to see if we can come up with any patterns depending on what the issue was with that particular patient. So we're at the very early stages of that, but it's really interesting stuff. You can imagine if we can come up with, you know, what some of those patterns are, then we can start to predict, get into the predictive side of things, and saying, you know, this patient that has this particular issue, you know, when these things line up from a physiological standpoint, we better start paying attention before that patient crashes. And maybe there's something we can do an hour, a half hour, even 15 minutes before to potentially even save that patient's life. So it's all real. I mean, these things they're happening out there today. There's also companies out there that have things, you know, what they call audience-centric marketing. And again, it's all creating that persona. And you can imagine from a healthcare perspective, it'd be unbelievable that as a patient walks into the hospital, for example, that very quickly we can have a patient persona of that individual. We know, you know, how they like to be communicated to. We know what their issues are. We have everything we need to know about that individual, so we can personalize their particular care and their particular stay at the healthcare facility. And it's something we're not there yet, yeah, but the data points are all out there for us to do. And there's some barriers in the way to do that. We're going to talk about, you know, what some of those things are going forward. Again, the other interesting things that we're starting to get into with our research side with UC Irvine Health is looking at, you heard a lot about genetics in the video, but also matching that with a phenotype, so that not only looking at what a person is predisposed to, say it's Parkinson's, for example, but with the phenotype, you're also looking at the behaviors of that individual, so that you can potentially predict maybe 10 years before that they actually have Parkinson's, that they are showing signs of that, particular disease. Not something that is present at the moment, but there's things that in the phenotype that you can discover. With that becomes very powerful. Now you can start to treat that person even before they actually show signs of their symptoms of that particular disease. So there's some really interesting data coming out on that as well, some interesting studies that you hear more about going forward. So with that kind of introduction, I am going to turn it over to my friends here and have them introduce themselves, tell a little bit about each other, and then I'll come back to me and I'll ask the first question and we'll go from there.
Okay, great. Well, good evening. Hope everybody can hear me in the back. My name is Sajad Yaku. I'm a general pediatrician at Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. And I think some of the things that are important to sort of talk about it and get in context, you know, first of all, that movie was amazing. I mean, it set a lot of the points that, you know, to think about. I think what's remarkable is the time that we live in. How many in the room are fans of Star Trek The Next Generation? Right? So immediately your mind went to the Borg, didn't it? Right? The collective Borg, where every person is part of a bigger collective and every bit of information is shared between all of them. I mean, in many ways, that's what they're describing, a Borg. Whether it's the Borg of the individual person, to get all my data and get to look at it, or the Borg of a collective population, everybody can look at that and see that. And that's what we're getting to, right? Between every bit of data we can get, the fact that, you know, Dallas Hospital is being able to take a look at the NICU and know for every heartbeat, for every second, the variation on that can predict who's going to have sepsis. And so I think that is what we're looking at. It's not just looking at data. There's architecture to get it, and there's systems and people that we have to put in place, and who knows, that little thing called privacy to get over, right? But all that leads to something about a Borg collective, and it's not a bad thing. You know, the first time I heard Borg, I thought of the chess player. I was completely wrong, right? It's more about this collective. And so, speaking of collective, I mean, that's what we've been trying to do at Children's Hospital Los Angeles. You know, we've had an EMR in place for a number of years. Somebody talked about, you know, 2000 was when that light turned on. For us, it was 1999 when the Institute of Medicine came out with a report about to err as human. And we did our work then to start thinking about, we needed care for patients better, and data was going to be the lifeblood of it. We wrote a white paper to get our hospital to start thinking about getting an EMR in place. And so that EMR has been developed over time. It's by no means perfect, but we now have it spread across all of our inpatient, ambulatory, and ED, and we monitor our patients, like you were talking about, being able to come up with an idea, becoming predictive, not just reactive or even preventive, but predictive. And so we monitor all of our patients, and we know who's at risk for sepsis. We have a little tool that runs all algorithms in there, data sets that are constantly monitored, like you're saying, data coming from monitors, but also data coming from lab sets, age, predictive models being done. That's in one setting in a hospital. Imagine if you started doing that outside of the hospital, like this was envisioning. You did that not just for data sets that we classically look at in medicine, like vital signs, but what about in my tweet, I used the word damn. Or use the word not happy, right? Being able to socially engineer and know how people are feeling and know not only how I'm feeling, but maybe how that might affect how everybody in this room feels because they know that tonight. That's where that collective comes in. So I think it's a great time to be in healthcare, especially, because we have the opportunity not only to start using that data in good ways, but set in place the culture to use that data. I think that's one of the biggest things we have to really think about. You have to get the culture of people to be able to do that, much like we did with EMRs, although the battle's not done, to get people to adopt. We have to get people to understand the culture of what it means to use data effectively. There is a dark side, but you know what they say, you know, culture trumps any plan. If you can get people to buy into the culture that data can be used for good, especially in healthcare, you'll mitigate a lot of those issues we have with the dark side. You won't get rid of it, but you definitely help people get to that spot. So I think that's the things that we can talk about tonight in terms of how we use it effectively at an individual level, but also at a population level as well.
Great. I'm Graham Hughes. I'm the Chief Medical Officer at SAS. Anyone heard of SAS before? Some of you. SAS is the largest privately held software company in the world, and all we do is analytics. We are the world's leader in advanced analytics, and so a lot of what you saw today is what we do all day, every day. Essentially, we're kind of the intel inside of analytics, which is a lot of the stuff that you end up seeing being done with data analysis, either in healthcare or beyond, is powered under the covers by SAS. My role is that I'm Chief Medical Officer at SAS, and I lead an innovation team looking at opportunities for advanced analytics, in particular in health and life sciences, pharma, med device, payer, provider, and also work with government. FDA, CDC, CMS, as well as state-level healthcare organizations, so state public health initiatives and state Medicaid, and so forth. So the one thing I would say is, of course, it's all about the data. I mean, why wouldn't it be? When I went into medicine, I think most of the physicians that I know and most of the clinical staff that went into medicine consider themselves at heart scientists, and science is rooted in data. And so I've never found a physician who, or a nurse, or anyone who's working in healthcare who's not interested in what data can do. The question really is what new things can be done and how do they fit into the business problems that we're dealing with? Because I look at the wonderful video, but I cast my mind back to when I was starting in medical school in the late 1979, early 1990s. So there you go, I'm dating myself. But what I remember is I used an electronic health record. I was a computer programmer who had been involved in programming and looking for patterns in neural development of chick embryos, of all things. And I started off using an electronic health record in the early 80s, and I thought, there you go, that's the future. This is going to be easy, everything will roll out. And you know, soon enough, we'll be using advanced decision support systems to move us towards problem-centric, evidence-based practice. And you know, today, where are we? So I think there's a long journey ahead of us, and I'm the biggest exponent of using big data and analytics. But the reality is it has to solve the problem. And you have to have all of the right ecosystem around it to make it work. The other thing is, you know, it was over 15, close to 15 years ago that the human genome was sequenced. Everyone, okay, we're gonna solve healthcare now. And we've seen some advances, but that transformation, the revolution takes time. So a lot of the things that we heard today, and again, I'm not trying to disparage any of that, but it's easy to think about all of the things that you could do, but the reality of the world is that there are things that you've got to do. And if, and I'll stop here, but the thing is that there was George Miller, I think some of you may be familiar, who's one of the most quoted scientific papers of all time from the 1950s, said that human beings are capable of processing 7 data points, plus or minus 2, depending on whether you're on a panel, it's probably 2 less. You've a little bit, got some time, you know, to yourself, maybe 9 if you're super intelligent. That really doesn't, that just means that the limitations of the human brain are far exceeded by the amount of data that's being thrown at us. But the problem is, if you go into your physician's office today, I would guarantee that 90 to 95%, maybe more of them, are using their cognitive capacity to try and make decisions that are super complex. So we've got to start somewhere, but I hesitate always with the sort of hubris or the extrapolation that says, hey, you know, all of these opportunities are opportunities, but the way that we're going to change the world is to actually do it at the point of care, and we're going to do it based on things that make business sense in the healthcare business that we all are involved with, which is, of course, patient-centric. So that said, I'll hand over.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Anthony Chang. I'm a pediatric cardiologist. I used to head the heart program here at Children's Hospital Orange County. About 5 years ago, when the supercomputer Watson beat the human contestants on the show Jeopardy, I'm sure some of you remember that night, was sort of my personal journey in artificial intelligence. That's when it began. I've always been interested in it, but I kind of realized, you know, I had an epiphany that I was here. And what a great opportunity for medicine, because I always thought medicine could really use a better interpretation of data. So fast forward another 4 or 5 years to today. I'm close to finishing the program at Stanford in informatics and artificial intelligence. I learned a great deal the last 4 or 5 years. And thanks to a grant from a Disney family member, we started an institute at Children's Hospital Orange County called the Medical Intelligence and Innovation Institute to put special emphasis on use of artificial intelligence in medicine, as well as innovation in pediatrics. And I just want to give a special shout out to a few people here that actually come to the monthly meeting we have on data and intelligence and innovation, as well as my Children's Hospital Orange County colleagues are here. But I think my, 4 or 5 years later, my sort of one of my big takeaways from all that education from very smart people at Stanford is how much the clinical world is disconnected from what's possible in data analytics. It's actually frighteningly large in terms of the disconnect. And at the same time, I think artificial intelligence, which incorporates methodologies like machine learning and natural language processing that we've been hearing about in the mainstream media, can really, what I say in medicine, make the visible invisible and make the invisible visible. And I know that sounds like a catchy phrase, but what we think of artificial intelligence is often the robot with the smart mind. In fact, I think in the future, it's going to make the doctors much more human because we'll have a lot more time for our patients, not being inundated with the technology and the electronic record. And by making the invisible visible, I mean, I think one of the lines in the movie actually alluded to that. There's so many pieces of knowledge, bits of knowledge that are buried in the data that the doctors and the nurses can't see. And it would be wonderful to raise them to the surface.
Thank you. By the way, I'm the only non-physician on the panel, so please don't hold that against us. He's at the plus two stage. So, you know, based on what we saw in the video, and we all, you know, I think we all agree that, you know, we need to build this ecosystem. We may have different ways that we look at it and how we're going to attack it. But, you know, what do you see as the biggest limitations or barriers that are in the way to getting to the point of some of the things that we saw in healthcare? You know, on the video, to be able to make that real going forward, whether it's in technology or whether it's in strategy, what do you see as some of those biggest barriers?
Sorry, I think there's several. One is the physicians, especially senior physicians, resistance to change, not being comfortable with new technology, and to the point of almost pushing back on anything that may potentially even make their lives easier. I think that leads to another very sobering finding, which is the observation that 95% or so of physicians are very unhappy with their careers right now. So when you're really mired in not being happy doing what you're doing, the last thing you want to get engaged is a new paradigm in making things better. So you think that some physicians will like to get more engaged, but in fact they haven't been. So I think some of the areas of concern would be the collective resistance to change in the first place, being more paternalistic and autonomous. And the second, and that coupled with, I think, a general sense of dissatisfaction in the healthcare business, I think it's going to create a challenge for us.
Yeah, I think I'd jump in and say fee-for-service doesn't require much analytics. So, you know, the predominant way that incentives have been structured over the years in this country don't push any real desire for people to try and figure out what's going on in the population. Once the patient leaves your office, it's thank goodness for that, I can move on to the next patient, and I can forget all about that patient. And then it's time to move on. And so I think, I mean, despite the sort of the innate desire of caregivers to help patients, is that there's no real systemic incentive, or hasn't been until recently, for people to change the way that they practice healthcare medicine. And there's no real need to understand risk, behavior, understand your patient as a true individual, and that most of the way that healthcare is being delivered is essentially through the accumulation of either folklore or evidence-based practice through the randomized double-blind clinical trial, and this sort of concept that what you could do is you could get evidence or data generating evidence or data generating, you know, evidence, should I say, medicine generating evidence, which is the practice of care actually generating the evidence, is completely back to front. So I would say that, and in combination with, it's always easier to have a legacy mindset. So there's not a lot of competitive pressure in there to make you behave like a retail organization, where you are trying to understand the customer as an individual because you've got fierce levels of competition around the way that you can interact with the customer. And so this sort of idea that you work in a siloed model with SQL-based enterprise data warehouses with one data model to rule them all is so archaic, but it's the easiest thing to latch onto if that's what you've always done. So I think there's a transformation in incentives, there's a transformation in technology understanding, there's a transformation in the willingness for people to start to see what's going on in the rest of the world and to be less insular. So I would say the other aspect of it is that, well, even now I see getting back to what you said, Chuck, which is, you know, there are no, well, you may have one. There are very few ecosystems for big data analysis and what, and I would, you might say, well, that's self-serving, Graham. You work for a company that, that spans the spectrum. Well, yeah, that's true to a certain extent. But to me, if I cast my mind back to the early 90s when I was implementing the first electronic health record system that I implemented, you know, there was still this huge debate about whether we should be buying piecemeal-based systems for every single department, or, you know, or whether we should have an order entry system differently in each different department, where pharmacy has a different one than lab, has a different one from radiology, and it's just nonsense. But, you know, we're seeing the same thing happen with fragmented analysis of data at the moment. Is there's no really broad enterprise platform-based ecosystem view. And I applaud what you're doing at UCI, because that's the way other industries have been doing this and thinking about this for the last 10 to 15 years.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to echo a good deal of what you said. I would say there's four things that are really sort of stopping us right now. Not the only ones, but I think four big ones. Certainly, the resistance to change, I think, is still a big one. But I think the model for that is changing a bit. Whereas we have older physicians or more experienced physicians who are resistant to that, the change resistance we're going to get later on is those folks who are now using their phones to communicate are going to want a different way of using things. And they're going to be resistant to having things stay the same. They're going to ask for differences in the way we do it. So that generational shift is even happening now. That how many of you have seen that classic YouTube video of the little 2-year-old or 15-month-old is trying to turn the page of a magazine by hitting it like it's an iPad? That's your patient or your future doctor. Their idea of how to use things is going to be vastly different than what we have right now. So it's going to be a different problem to solve there around that resistance. The second part is just, we mentioned, right, incentives. Who's going to have an incentive? How are we going to get people to do this? It's great to put a Fitbit on somebody, but you got to get them to run. You got to give them a reason to do that, right? Not just some great, cool Nike commercial, but a good, compelling reason. You know, there's a great YouTube video out there that talks about, if you ever saw the Sochi Olympics in 2014, Sochi, Russia had a huge, and has a huge obesity epidemic. They wanted to figure out, how do I incentivize people to change things? So what they did was, in their subway, they put up a video camera in a computer booth, and they said, listen, if you stand here and do 30 squats, we will give you a subway token for free. And of the 700 or so people who actually stopped and looked at this and did this, guess how many completed all 30 squats for a free token? All 700. Now, the computer looked to make sure you did it, but it gave you that feedback. And guess what they did? There was an incentive there, so I agree. We have to have incentives for people to do things. The third thing is still around vendors and us, right? We are like 2-year-olds in a sandlot. We just don't like to share all that much. We've got to be willing to share our data. We have to have not only just interoperability. That's one thing. I can be interoperable. That's great. But if I don't give up my data, interoperable means nothing. I've got to have incentives to get big organizations, little organizations, the federal government, everybody to share data. And last but not least, by the way, how many people have a unique national identifier for their patient record? Right. Well, maybe you, sir, but you're probably in a different... Are you on Mars, where they actually have water now? Europe. Well, there you go. See, we don't have that here. If you ever, anybody here ever go to South Korea, it's fascinating. They have no qualms about sharing data. You walk into a pharmacy, your name will be on a big board and tell you exactly what medicine you're waiting for. If it's a blue pill or not, they don't care. Right? So that idea of security and privacy is huge in this country, and it's an obstacle. It's important. And you saw the dangers in that video when we talked about, there is that dark side, but there's so much good, but we've got to get past that concern about security and privacy, and how do we solve that? So I think, by the way, these are not insurmountable. They can be solved, and technology, you ask any technology person, technology is not the problem. We can build whatever we want. It's all these other things, and that gets into the whole idea of the culture. If we give it that culture of being able to both value and understand the value and importance of big data and get people to buy into how to use it, that will start to change all that. So I think those are the major areas that we start to think about. By no means all of them, but certainly ones that would probably be very difficult to tackle at first.
I think what's promising in the future, Chuck, is the spirit of collaboration. And at least amongst children's hospitals, we've been gathering for the last couple of years trying to form a coalition to do things like share data and share ideas of innovation. And I think we're getting a lot of great feedback, trying to keep the momentum going. We're about 50 hospitals now out of about maybe 500 children's hospitals around the world, and I think we can actually form that coalition. And Sajid and I were talking about it on the way up the stairs to the reception, that you know, one of the great things about learning from Stanford is there are so many people that are so wealthy from their internet enterprises that they're just coming back to Stanford to teach their wisdom. And I'm very fortunate right now, one of the professors is one of the founding fathers of the cloud computing, and the first takeaway was so important, which was, if everyone is obsessed and worried about security, you're actually more secure sharing your data rather than keeping your data in a silo at your local hospital. And hopefully with that kind of change in mindset and thinking about security, we can actually have the rationale that it's much better to share data.
I might add, pediatricians in general like to share, and we're good at that collaborating, because our incentive is solely not based on money, for sure. I'm just saying.
Can I ask the other question before he moves on? It's related to what you asked. So you described that whole initiative of finding the data to catch the patient before the sepsis comes on. Mm-hmm. How tough is it to get something like this from a lab, scientific research lab, to actual implementation and seeing the outcomes? And I want to know what regulatory hurdles are there and what other hurdles would be.
So the question was around, you know, we have this tool in place in our EMR that looks for 13 different data points related to our patient, whether it's vital signs, labs, et cetera, documentation, and use that to predict who might be at risk for sepsis. The question was, how difficult was it to get from sort of the lab into the real life? I will tell you again, the technology was not the issue. The issue was agreement, which 13 data points do we use? There's many studies out there that point to which ones we should use. Are we going to use these ones here? It was around the very fundamental thing of, even though a lot of our stuff is fully electronic and totally digital, at some point someone has to write something down or put something in the system. The discussions and hours we had over who would put that in, when they would put it in, and how often they would put it in was remarkable. Even though everybody in the room was completely incented to say this is the right thing to do, it was amazing around that. So data entry, right, was a huge deal. So workflow becomes a very important thing. So I would say it took us a long time to do that because of all those hurdles around that. Regulatory, I would say, I mean, maybe we were just sort of naive, but there wasn't a lot of things we were worried around that. We knew that this was important for our patients, and because of the way we did the process of how we looked at it and who would look at it, that would be an issue. Our risk managers would for sure say, this is an issue. If you're going to put something like that in place, how are you ensuring that everybody's looking at this at the right time? Who knows about it, and when do you know about it? So those were some of the hurdles we had to do. I think, again, we will never get to a spot where anybody will turn anything on that's perfect. We'll always have errors in it. Our biggest and best challenge is to make sure that we minimize those errors and move quickly on to the next thing. Not stay in one place and get mired in that. It didn't work, we can't go on further from it.
I think that we have to make it effortless for the clinicians to be able to react. I mean, we still, anytime I think involve humans to enter data or to analyze data or do a certain chore in a hospital, it's going to be, I think, very, very difficult to pull off.
And what I'm seeing at UCI Health, too, and working with physicians, and you guys can help with this as well, is that what we're trying to do is more in the way of suggestive analytics as opposed to predictive. We don't see the physicians that we're working with that they're ready for the predictive piece so much that, you know, we're basically telling you what to do. You know, the computer's going to tell you what to do, right? You get back to the cookbook and that kind of medicine. Whereas a suggestive analytics is more about, well, we think this is happening. What do you think? So then, you know, the computer gives you those ideas, but then, you know, you have to take it to the next level. So we're finding that that's much more receptive than the predictive, hardcore, this is what's going to happen type of approach. So I don't know if you guys, your physician. So.
I think that's a great point. And, you know, again, one of my takeaways at Stanford is it really has to be a human-computer partnership rather than one having a dominant role over the other. Right. And I think, you know, 5 years ago when I gave talks on AI in medicine, it was this very emotional pushback from the physicians about, you know, being possibly replaced by, you know, AI. Now I'm sensing a much more much more harmony in terms of, now it's just curiosity rather than an emotional pushback, and hopefully in the future it'll be a welcoming thing for physicians to look at artificial intelligence in medicine.
Right. Yeah, no, I'd agree with that. I don't think, we used to talk even in the days of electronic health record decision support is guided care. You know, even if you're recommending to someone that they should, you know, check a potassium level because the potassium level is low and you're putting them onto Joxin and there's some drug, you know, lab interaction. You know, you're not going to change the dosage of that drug. You know, you can't do that. It doesn't make any sense. But there are some interesting situations where I think it's about, not about telling the physician what to do, but there are some types of closed loop algorithms that I think are really interesting at scale. So for example, the things that, say Zulily does, who just been bought by QVC, anyone ever heard of Zulily?
Yep.
Okay, so what they do is you know, they're essentially kind of an online shopping channel, just being bought by the TV shopping channel, and they have a slightly younger audience, but what they do is they do massive scale A-B testing on how to present pages and components of pages, so that after about 2 or 3 months of using this, the people on that site look a little kind of cooler, kind of better looking version of you, but that they anticipate exactly what you aspire to be, and they're marketing to you all the time. And the only reason I said this is that when we're starting to see health plans and healthcare delivery systems that are looking at how do I think about intervention optimization where I can outreach to patients at scale and that I can compute extremely large combinatorial problems to make sometimes closed loop action, sometimes just recommendations. Closed loop action might just be as simple as saying, hey, you know what, this patient after you know, interacting this way, and this way, we know now that interacting with them this way, not changing the drug, but actually just outreaching to them with a phone call or with, you know, with email or telling them to download an app, that gives us a better response rate. And it's all about percentage points then. In retail, if you get 1 or 2 or 3% uptick, it's not about solving world hunger or changing everybody. It's a matter of starting to put in place at times some closed loop algorithms that allow you to scale. Instead of someone making a decision one at a time, it's allowing you to make decisions at the scale of tens of thousands of people, which is what you've got to start to do in pop health, and then obviously guiding or providing potential choices for people at the point of care.
Yeah, I mean, believe it or not, it's true, but humans and physicians are one and the same thing. So we respond that same way. I will tell you, even in our order sets, well, we know you should be ordering this for this patient, we say recommended. It's amazing how that works. Or even more so, for those of you that know about decision support, when it pops up in your face, I mean, there's a lot of attended issues with that, not just alert fatigue. But if you put the word of the name of the person it's coming to, believe it or not, that has a much better effect. So if a word comes up and says, you have a patient that's at risk, that's not the same as saying, Sajad, you have a patient that may be at risk. It does wonders. So there is this whole thought about how to use the principles that marketing uses all the time to sell, to really sell how to do better medicine. It does work, and it is that point that you want to gain about how to make that come into practice. You don't learn that going in, you learn that by a lot of trial and error, seeing people respond as humans to what they're seeing in front of them.
Yeah, and the other thing I liked, just to kind of take off from that, is one of the things I liked in the, and at least it's been my experience over the last 20 years, working full-time in health informatics and healthcare IT, is that what they said, and I heard it a couple of times, is that you have to make the data tell a story. If you're just raining or hosing data at people, it doesn't really do anything. And you know, even these sorts of control charts or showing people bar charts of prior performance, it's like, yeah, so what does that really mean? What do you want me to do about it? And so, you know, I really like Pamela Peel from UPMC says, hey, you know what we need to do is we need to hire data scientists and journalists, because we don't tell the story well enough. We don't know what these data mean, and if I just leave it to the data scientists, they're going to confuse the heck out of people, and if I just left it to the journalists, they'd make stuff up. So I need something in the middle, and if I can hybridize those two people, I'm going to start to get something really wonderful, because I've got a story that I can tell, and I've got something that is actionable, and that, you know, that I can understand.
Yeah, And there's a great TED talk out there by the editor of Wired magazine, Thomas Goetz, who talked about the visual representation of data. Just Google that on TED Talk. It's a great point to this exactly about, it's not just data telling you something, but it's actionable and tells you what to do next.
Thank you for asking the first question, Giannis, because I definitely want to get to you folks. So I'm going to open it up, and what I'd like you to do is if you could, you know, speak loudly so everybody can hear you.
We have mics.
Oh, you're going to mic, great. And then we can, if you want to direct it to one individual, you can do that, or to the entire panel. It's up to you. Somebody in here? Somebody in the back?
My name is Alan Jeremy. One of the issues you mentioned about the privacy and security, you should fire all the U.S. Senate people because the HIPAA was 20 pages, and after they went through them, it was over than 200 pages. You should fire them. But the other
that's just government in action, all I can say.
But as far as the next generation of healthcare is smart medications. They are coming in, FDA is approving some of them, which you take a pill, you're the diabetic, the pill has a wireless and a laboratory inside of that, you automatically, you walking in and reporting to some call center, which is the physicians and the other type of nurse practitioner, you're monitoring. And if I'm a diabetic, I don't care about the privacy anymore, because I won't be monitoring you all the time, especially if I do have my heart problem, my rhythm of my heart, I want to monitor. And I think 2015 all the way to 2025 is going to be healthcare. It used to be 70s and 80s aerospace, now it's a healthcare. And that's how this migration is going to go.
Certainly.
And in 2030, we're going to be in Mars.
I think what you are seeing is certainly reflected in Silicon Valley, in terms of venture capital money that's going into healthcare. This is the biggest year in the last 8 or 9 years. And a lot of money is going into data and wearable technology. So I think you're absolutely right. The next 5 to 10 years, we're going to see, I'm predicting not a bubble, but a lot of strong interest in this area. Because if you think about this, we talk about data, the sheer amount of money that we're wasting not utilizing data in an intelligent way. Does anyone know, as a guess, how much of the $3 trillion we spend in healthcare could be saved if we are just more smart about data in very basic ways? Any guesses? It's $500 billion will be saved. So I think that money could be so much better used, right, in healthcare in our country if we just use data a little bit more intelligently.
Yeah, it's amazing the private equity money that's coming in. I've got some friends that are in that side of the business, and there, if you can generate as a data analytics, even with a bad idea, but something that gets you $10 to $20 million in revenue, right now it's going for 15 times revenue. 15 times you can sell these companies for, and you see it happening all the time. And these are products that are, you know, SQL based, you know, data warehouses that have dead ends. There's no way they're going to get to anything that we're talking about, anything that we saw in the video. So,
well, if anyone's looking for a great startup idea, you raised it, which is, I'll tell you what I want, and I believe that we're going to see a lot more of over the next 5 to 10 years, is patient-centric, consent-based systems that are cloud-based. So I want to say, do I invite you, you, and you into my network for what purpose, for what period of time, and what data do I want you to see? Because, as you say, if I'm a diabetic, I may actually say, look, I'm going to invite anyone in who can help me for my diabetes. I don't want them to see anything else. So there is no really good, I mean, there are a few interesting ideas out there, but there's no really good patient-centric, scalable, consent-based model that allows people to have confidence that they can invite people into their treatment plan. So there you go. It's, just give me 50% of whatever you
So two things. One, that is turning the EMR into Facebook, which is one of the ways of getting that whole product. But I would say that, you know, I agree with you. I think you're happy to say that, hey, I don't care that anybody else knows my diabetes is this much. I want it to be solved, and that's great. However, I think you would be not so happy to know if your employer knew about that and suddenly started cutting your shift or changing your insurance plan because they recognized, because they tapped into it, know how to control your diabetes is, and they don't want you at work.
Yeah, but I can't go to my congressman and tell him that change the rules.
Yeah, well, but the point is, even if we didn't have those rules, if everybody knew about that, there are ways, like they said in the film, there are ways that people start to use it nefariously, also subtly, that we don't even know about yet. So we always have to guard against that. I, as a physician, would say, yes, I applaud the need for us to share that data, because that'll help you. Because even if you're with an endocrinologist doing a great job, maybe the one down the street, you know, in Children's Hospital Los Angeles can do a better job. You don't know that unless you share that data, unless you get someone else to come in and look at that. So that's great, but there's always a double-edged sword to that.
I agree with you, but the most of the, if you look at the cost of the data in Europe and over here, the European Commissioner, they're looking for the 5G to solve their problem and bring their cost of the data. The same way I mentioned that with the smart medications. Mm-hmm. Then we don't have any more choices. Otherwise, we're going to pay so much money that the lawmakers are going to make some law to protect me and from my employer.
The potential for Congress to screw things up is immense.
No, I don't have to tell you, I used to be over there. Not as a congressman, so I'm working with them.
I think another area that's going to be a challenge in terms of the debate in this country is as all the wearable technology come in and all the medications you can track with nanotechnology, is do we still have our individual flexibility to do something for health? And there's already emerging trend for payers to base their premiums and their payouts on how compliant you are based on technology. So there are going to be a segment of our population that no matter what the technology is going to want to decide on their own what they want to do with their disease. So what do we do with those patients?
Yeah, I mean, this is where data really makes sort of healthcare much more equal, right? It's not just physicians or insurance companies, but patients having a say in it, good or bad, in terms of how much they want or don't want. I mean, being able to say if you're compliant with something is great, maybe you cut your premiums, but also if your employer finds out about that, or your school finds out about that, you know, there's where the double-edged sword come in. Who knows the data when, and what are they going to use it for?
So if we need to
get another question. So far from everything that you guys have been saying, first of all, my name is Sudish, and I used to work for an IVD company, so some of my questions might be biased from there. So far, what have you guys been talking about has been very altruistic, that data can come from anywhere, and as long as it's good for people, you can use it. When will companies like SAS stop chasing the Western medicine world and start looking at people as units of data and going to traditional Chinese medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, chiropractors, where you don't have an organized sector, and you can create that new space where sharing can happen, and then teach to the world where you're chasing this payer and insurer-based model to now say that the true information is coming from people and can be shared by them? Why don't the Western world change that model?
Well, I'm not sure I fully understand the question, but essentially, we're agnostic to the work that is done, and so we're not trying to perpetuate any form of old model or a model that is, you know, patriarchal or you know, in any way. So I'll give you an example. So for example, we have convened a clinical trial data consortium for data sharing, where we are the Switzerland that provides the data integration, the data security, and the data analytics at the core, where clinical trial data from the top 15 to 20 big pharma companies is pooled. And if there are additional data, complementary medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, acupuncture, if there's data there, bring it, you know. So it's not that we're dictating, we are simply the arms dealers that provide the capability to whatever problem needs to be solved. And so I think you're probably asking the wrong person. We will let anyone use our tools for any purpose, and we'll help people who have a business need to utilize our tools. It's we're not trying to dictate policy in any way, at least
next.
I'm not.
I think there are three data tsunamis that are coming. One is the genomic information that you heard about in the video, when everyone gets sequenced. The second one is going to be patient-centric information like in social media, for instance. And then the third one is going to be the wearable technology. I think when all three are hitting us full force, we're woefully unprepared for that. And I think that's when the patients really have to take over as the maintenance person of their own healthcare data, including all the segments of healthcare that you talked about.
Well, and actually, I was going to say the other thing is that, to your point, there's waves. I think of them as transactional, collaborative, which is kind of the 2.0, and then I think it's knowledge-driven. And so what we're seeing is this idea of how do you become knowledge-driven as we move from transactional, collaborative, and then knowledge-driven. And that's something that no one is, we're just right in the early stages of that.
If I answered your question, let me just reframe it. I think what you're going to see is that with the value of data coming from so many different sources, an area where traditionally we never looked at, because it's hard to measure, how does taking that route help someone? Right? The pharmacogenetics of it, the pharmacology of it was never understood very well, so we discarded it. But with data, now you have a much more level playing field. And I think what's going to happen is, maybe to your question, it doesn't matter who's looking at it, the data will speak for itself. Yeah. And we'll point to that. And I think that's where we'll get that sort of, you know, sort of unifying principle of making everything equal and only the data will speak and allow it to say, you know what, it doesn't matter if it was from a root or from a pill manufactured in a lab, the efficacy is clear. This one works, this one doesn't. And that's what we'll get to.
Well, and actually,
democratization of cure.
Absolutely.
Not democratization of care, but cure.
Yeah, now Republic is it. Sorry, I didn't mean that.
Yeah, I think the other, actually, one thing I'd add to that is that I was chatting to some folks in the pharmaceutical industry, and they said where they're going is that their funding is going towards every disease becoming a rare disease. We saw that before, which is there's not just one type of lung cancer or one type of breast cancer. There are actually dozens and maybe hundreds of different types at the metabolic level. And so, but it gets even better than that, which is that, as you say, you start to throw in sociodemographic, behavioral, and other data around what the individual believes, perceives, preferences, and what their other things that they're doing in their lives. And then you get every disease being a very rare disease, because the way it applies to you and your circumstances is almost an N of one.
Well, not almost. It is an N of one. So I think we have to get away from thinking of population response to drug A versus drug B, and therefore you should take drug B. I think in the future you're going to have your own individual recipe, and that's why the push for precision medicine rather than even just personalized medicine. I think precision medicine implies that you're taking not just your own personal data, but now you're looking at the entire population to support what choice should you make for the best therapy.
Yes. Yeah, we'll talk about it offline, because there's a scaling issue associated with that. That's all I was getting at. I agree.
Yeah. All right, and another question here. You could talk about a whole job controlling these guys. Let's keep going. Right there.
It's been a great discussion, and to all of your guys' points, they've been really great. But Dr. Hughes, one of the points that you brought up in terms of, you know, how slow the change has been, or how we keep talking about this, I've been in this industry for 3 years now, and I'm kind of getting a little impatient when I keep hearing population health and personalized medicine. And it wasn't until I recently started doing my MBA here that I realized that, it, you know, with respect to healthcare systems, it's really the business model that we're in right now. And yeah, we're seeing the change with meaningful use coming in and incentives coming more and more. But I've also noticed that, you know, the organization is slow at investing in areas of innovation. I mean, all of a sudden now with a lot of hospitals, I see, oh, we have like an innovation department, innovation center coming up. But I guess, what are your guys' thoughts in terms of those strategies that can really, because it seems like the business model really drives the innovation. To your point, yeah, we have a lot of technology right now, but it's really those strategies. And what are some of the strategies you guys have seen or think that could help with population health, or, you know, just overall?
Well, I think this is an extremely complex question, but I think that there's local level innovation activity, which is, you know, the kind of thing that these guys are doing, and then that can gain momentum. The other is that there's the sort of the top down, the SIM grants at the sort of the state level. There's the CMS innovation team that are trying to push and pilot and measure and understand what the implications of some of these more transformational models of care are. And so, you know, then you've got PCORI and these other entities that are trying to fund exploratory pieces of work, because you know, people know that there are transformational opportunities. It's just difficult if you leave it simply to the market to figure it out sometimes, because you know, you don't have a coordinated ecosystem that grows up in that type of model. So you know, you've got to balance the innovation from the grassroots with the sort of the coordinated innovation from the top down. That's my two cents.
The market doesn't always have the priority of you in mind. And I think that's one of the things that's somewhat unique about medicine we have to keep in mind. Having said that, I think to your point, where will the innovation come? It will come with consortiums where you have collaboration between public and private partnerships, and especially communities. Because healthcare at its root still, to me, has to be funded and done at a community level. You still have to be able to get to those folks who don't have access to everything, and that's what data democratization will do, is allow that accessibility and therefore make it much more useful for them. And so, I think there is a way to do this. I think innovation will happen, but it's not going to be driven by the market alone, because those priorities are uniquely different in many ways. It has to be prompted by money, but I think the use cases and where it becomes really effective will be done by those collaborations.
I think actually the other thing is that I don't know how much time we've got left, but very quickly I'll say that I think we're at that stage, at least the discussions that I have, and I'm not saying either that I have complete clarity, but I think the discussions we're having are rather like the discussions that Van Leeuwenhoek was having when he was seeing the animalcules and looking into that microscope, is that the discussion about what's really going on with this whole world of data is clouded by a lack of clarity on the semantics and the terminology and the syntax that we use and the grammar. And so there's an evolving space here, because I think it's too easy for us to continually talk past each other, where, you know, at one time we're talking about big data and then we're talking about cool technology, and they're just different things, and we need to get a grammar over the next decade, I guess, to try and figure out how to talk about this.
So I have a two-part question. Somebody commented that we had a great technology today, and I would also say we have great medicine today, but drug compliance is an issue. And as a medical practitioner, you are, what innovation you would like to see in terms of technology or data being used to really drive drug compliance? And second part question is also somewhat related. And, you know, while the patients are under physician's care, they do well. But once they go home, they don't do as well. And so the whole life cycle, care management really is important. And again, what can technology, what can data be used to drive innovation in that regard? I'd just like to hear your comment.
Cool. What you essentially described is not medicine, it's human behavior. I mean, as a physician, essentially what I always do is I try and change behavior. Patient comes in, is sick, I give them medicine, I say, take this for 7 days, 3 times a day. I'm asking them to change their behavior. They don't normally do this. I want them to do this. What's their incentive? So I've got to understand that innovation you're talking about is really, what's the best way to understand human behavior and modify that and give them an incentive. In fact, this whole point about incentives, how do I give someone an incentive that's going to do that? Usually for something like that, the incentive is your fever will go away, you'll feel better, maybe. But how do I sustain that? So what you describe, when you leave a doctor's office, you may have all the knowledge in the world, you go home and something's not there. That ubiquity we talked about, the data, giving that constant feedback, that's what will change if you allow that opportunity for that patient or that person to constantly get that feedback in different ways. Not just the physician saying it, but maybe your mother, father, spouse, whoever's saying it, and or that little device that you have now that actually speaks to you in a great accent, because accents work well, and tells you it's the best thing for you to do, not to take that, but to take this pill now. That behavior change and all the tools that go to that, that's what we've got to understand. The tools will be there, but what's the best way to understand the psychology of behavior change? That's what we should invest more time in, understand how we can make that happen, sustain that across the life cycle of any person.
I think you're seeing really great use of technology, and I think one of the main pitfalls of technology is people, and sometimes physicians, are so enamored with their own advance in technology, they think they can sell it to patients and payers. when in fact you should really think about how to leverage technology to solve a problem. And I think you see good examples of that now where, you know, the average number of medications that an American above 60 some years of age take is 12. How do you manage 12 medications at different schedules, even for people who are very lucid without Alzheimer's and everything, is a huge challenge. So I think you see reminders and easy technology that can really help to mitigate some of the problems and challenges that you see there. And then, of course, there's a lot of surge, there's a recent surge in looking at sort of teleclinic kinds of concepts. And we recently visited Eric Topol down in San Diego, and he's a proponent of eliminating clinics altogether, so that you only have the hospital seeing the sickest and most acute patients, but he's convinced that most patients you can see, you know, virtually at home rather than bringing them into the clinic. I have to agree that even for my patients, pediatric cardiac patients, I can probably see a good 20-30% in a virtual format rather than bringing them into the clinic all the time.
Yeah, the only other thing I'd say is that I'm a strong believer in the force multiplier of the clinical team. So you can go after the individual, and they're in isolation, not an insolvable problem, but that it's tough. And particularly if you think that you can sort of interact with them without a cross-continuum care delivery system that is thinking broadly. And so the way that I've been trying to think about this is to, you know, if you take medication adherence, less than 50% of patients keep taking their medications, you know, on schedule in this country. And the reality of that is that's multifactorial. So there's just, it's a predictive big data problem where you need to try and figure out what you, in my opinion, what you need to tell to the care team and what you need to tell to the physician, to the patient, sorry. And then you have to change the whole care team, because the care team has got to start to feel accountable for that problem, which is of course the way that the ACA is moving things in population health management right now. The patient doesn't suffer any penalty if they don't do it, except for their long-term or maybe short-term health. And the physician and the care team, you know, up until recently, did have no skin in the game either. And so it's a systemic problem, but they're one that can be informed by running large-scale data analysis. And that is one example that drug companies look at all the time, is how do I keep people taking these meds when they're actually helping them? And it's a big problem.
You know, one quick thing I will say that might answer that, for those of you that have angry birds on their phone, the gamification of health is a great way of doing that. When you think about it, angry birds doesn't pay you anything. You don't get anything from it other than that satisfaction. If you gamify health and show people that, there's a possibility that you could increase compliance by them doing something for no other reason other than the satisfaction they get out of it.
So can I switch to, so we, you know, we started with this wonderful movie about kind of incredible promise, and the last half an hour to 45 minutes has been focused on all the problems that we have in bringing technology and data to solve our problems. So let me ask you, with the more optimistic point of view, what are you doing today that is the most innovative thing each of your hospitals is doing? Something that is in production, not something that's sitting in a lab somewhere, but like something that you didn't think you would see 3 years ago, that you're doing it and it's in production. And Graham, for you, perhaps something that you've seen from one of your customers. But let's just move this in terms of like, what are we doing already that you didn't think we'd be doing? What is really making a difference using kind of what we're talking about?
I can take a quick cut at it. There's a number of things, but one that we're in pilot phase on at the moment, but it goes back to, I think, one of the things that they showed earlier on, which is the idea of taking real-time, twice a second streaming data from the fetal strip, bringing in additional maternal data that's coming in directly from the EMR in real-time, combining that with the CTG recording, so the uterine contractions and the fetal heart rate, and then running large-scale big data and analytics against that to try and find out who has a low outcome score, which babies are not going to do well immediately after birth, and then which of those kids you know, may end up with brain injury. And so the earlier that we can predict that, the better. We're in the process of doing it, but the idea of streaming data at dozens of data points a second into a real-time algorithm that can then compute and provide guidance back to the clinician, the nurse, or the physician, or even to the patient in real time, not running asynchronous state decision support. That those are things that, you know, I would always hoped for, but that we're starting to see now, where we're providing real-time analysis of streaming data. And that's kind of exciting to me.
Yeah, I mean, I would just echo what I said earlier, you know, that our ability to run 13 different data points in real time and update them continuously to inform people about which of their patients are at risk for sepsis, I think is very cool. But I think just as cool, it may sound mundane, but even just our ability for someone to enter in an order for a lab and be notified of that lab result without thinking about it, it gets pushed out to them. I mean, it sounds mundane to do, but that is something you couldn't even think of 10 years ago. And last but not least, we are a little bit behind the times, but we're finally doing barcoding of medications and doing barcoding administration. That's a huge thing to do. Not every hospital in the country has it. Certainly, Chalk has a lot, but it's that. It finally took us that long, not because the technology was not there, but because back to that issue of culture and priorities, getting people to both recognize and put the money forward to do that was a big deal. We had a lot of other things going on, rightly so, but getting to that point, it's a huge deal for us now that we're live with that. So I would say, to me, that's some of the cool things.
Again, I think at Children's Hospital Orange County, we try to use technology and use artificial intelligence and stick to very basic things you want to change. I think it's often very hard to not be distracted by what's really state-of-the-art and be thinking about the hottest, you know, device and forgetting what is your mission and your vision for a children's hospital. So one thing that we're trying to espouse in our hospital is this culture of appreciating how much data can really make a difference in acute care, and we've done a couple of projects in that area, but also for children on a chronic care basis and a population health basis. So I think the most important thing is for everyone to be aware of, to unleash the power of data and be aware of that and be sensitive to that, and then try to, again, cross that bridge between data science and patient care. It's not unusual for us now to have a data scientist on our team when we round. And when I asked that in another meeting, very, very few people were doing that. So I think that should be the beginning of using data science in a hospital.
Yeah, one other example, I mean, there's millions of them, but one other one that I think is cool is some work we're doing around taking cancer registry data, large-scale pooled cancer registry data, and going in there and saying, I don't know what works best, but we go interrogate the data and say, what treatment sequences do I think that I can see as I do machine learning against these data? So I'm not looking for someone who's on CHOP or a particular type of regimen for their leukemia or their prostate cancer. I'm looking for sequences in the data that look like the patterns. And when I get those patterns, then what I do is I can take other clinical data to look at subsegments of the population and say, okay, I have an Asian male between the ages of 50 and 65 who's had prostate cancer, who started off with watchful waiting, then went into chemotherapy, then ended up with surgery, whatever it may be. And then I'm just using letting the data tell the story. So what happens in that case is that we're starting to learn, and it's early stages, and we're starting to learn not only what we thought would happen, but when we're in the real world, what actually happens outside of the clinical trial, and which treatment sequences work better for different subsets of patients. So essentially, when, you know, the goal would be that in 5 years' time, is that, you know, when the patient's in front of you, is you'll be able to say, here's what evidence-based medicine would suggest that you do now. But oftentimes, we really don't have the right answer, or we don't have much granular information. You could say, hey, actually based on an analysis of 10 million patients that we now have, here seem to be the types of things that based on the outcome that the patient cares about or that you're looking for, here might be the right treatment sequence for you to consider because it has statistical validity and that here's the data that we have. And of course, human beings are not very good at computing that stuff at scale. So as an example of patients like you might do better with treatments like this, but we never knew that before.
I think also one of the most exciting, one takeaway that's exciting that's coming up in the next 3 to 5 years in healthcare data and databases is a whole change in paradigm on how we do data and databases. And you know, right now it's a relational database. It's been around for 30, 40 years. And when I go to the NIH and talk about, well, what about changing the database paradigm? Because biomedical healthcare data is ideally suited for graph database. If you really think about it, it's three-dimensional, it's much more usable, especially with the complexity of healthcare data. And people will say, well, you know, you're always talking about something that's going to be available 10, 20 years from now. And I say, you know, what uses graph databases, LinkedIn, Match.com. I mean, all of these, you know, public domains are using graph databases. So if you ask me what's the one thing I wish could happen right now in healthcare would be, in terms of data, would be to totally change our mindset about and welcoming, hopefully, a new era for graph databases.
And I wish I had enough data to predict what the Lakers would do this year. But.
You actually kind of hit on it. I was actually looking more of a time frame, maybe like the next 1 to 3 years, and maybe startups or companies that you've come into contact with that you think is really, say you're an angel investor, you know, venture capitalist, that you would, you know, look at as somebody that has an advantage, early mover advantage, with some of the topics we've discussed tonight.
You know, one of the ones that I really saw recently, and we were talking about it before, is a company called Validic, and essentially Validic are a company that deals with gathering data from a myriad of medical devices that were, you know, including fitness trackers and so forth. And their model is very much of a mint.com model, where it's a model where the individual has to provide authorization directly that their credentials can be utilized for a particular purpose, and then what happens is that the Validic acts as a pass-through without ever seeing the data. It's then being able to be made available to organizations, provided the patient provides consent. So essentially, it's the patient at the core of that that says, out of all of these hundreds of devices that I may have or may have in the future, kind of aggregating those and doing the data aggregation around it so that it can then be passed through into an EMR or passed through into an app or passed through into another startup. So, you know, that's a huge area. The Internet of Things, as it surrounds you as a patient, is that getting a common broker layer there, and Validic are trying to do that. There are probably others who are trying to do it, but I think that's a huge opportunity, because, you know, otherwise, what are we going to do? Like, connect to every single device? Everyone's going to try and connect to every single device. There's going to have to be some sort of broker.
Yeah, we're working with a startup right now, UC Health, and basically building the ecosystem I talked about earlier, where if you think about how people build apps, you know, you don't build things from scratch anymore. If you need a search engine, you license Google to pull into your app, things like that. So they're doing the same thing. There's open source systems out there that you can bring into your ecosystem rather than trying to build it all out yourself. And you want to create that ecosystem in a way that you can move around and be nimble. And it can change, almost like a living human being. It can change very quickly and very easily based on other source systems that you want to pull in, whether it's sensor data or whatever it might be. So building that is very, very difficult, as you can imagine, because of API structures and things like that you need to have in place. But once you have something like that, it becomes very, very powerful. Because now it's just, you know, plug and play on source systems as you go forward. And you can run hundreds and hundreds of use cases through it, as opposed to 3 or 4 or 5 use cases, because you've got to build each one, you know, separately. So there are companies, Validic is getting into that space. The one we use is called ClearSense. And you're starting to see more and more of those types of companies coming out there that, you know, are Hadoop-based, not SQL-based. And I think that's what the future's
going to be. Yeah, the other thing I'm very excited about, and we're actively involved in, is looking at using these interoperability techniques, real-time interoperability techniques, to get back into workflow. So Smart on Fire, as an example, is, I think, a huge opportunity for standardizing and to create an ecosystem of app developers that can then be pushed back into the workflow that's monolithically controlled by electronic medical record vendors at the moment. And it is the best bet that we have at the moment, I think, for actually incorporating analytic output and analytic insight and analytic recommendations back into workflow to the clinical staff who are making the decision at the point of care.
Question?
Question. I'm just curious to know, most of the talk looks like there's so much physician resistance to the data. Like senior physicians are not adopting big data concepts. But if they were adopting medical advances and diagnostic technologies like ultrasound, CT scan, MRIs, they're not technology averse. They like technology. But probably is big data not the is it not ready for them to present? Like, why are they not adopting big data while they are adopting other technologies in diagnosis? You know, do they not have confidence in the data? Or?
You're asking about the advances in interpreting diagnostic testing?
Yeah.
The essence of the question? Oh, yeah, there's huge strides in the last 5 years, especially, and you may not be aware of it because they're just startups, they're just getting going. One of them is analytic, that's looking at machine learning, looking at MRIs and CT scans, and hopefully in the future, ultrasound and echocardiograms even. I just took a course at Stanford talking about medical imaging and AI technology. It is absolutely staggering how powerful machine learning is for medical imaging. I'm pretty confident that within 5 years or so, there's going to be less and less radiologists interpreting the medical images by themselves. They're all going to be armed with these new amazing algorithms and machine learning that will help the doctors see not just what's obvious, but pick up on early signs of disease that they're not particularly good at right now. So I expect a lot of big breakthroughs, and I think you're already hearing about them in the news, with different AI methodologies being now tied to GE and tied to medical imaging companies, because the amount of big data, we talk about big data in healthcare, the amount of imaging data just in the last year doubled from the year before. I mean, it's just astronomical. MRI images are just totally through the roof right now in terms of quantity of data. So humans can't do it anymore.
But to your question about why aren't they using it, et cetera, I mean, fundamentally gets back to this. Think about this. We've known for over 30 years what it takes to make a patient safe once they leave the hospital after a myocardial infarction, heart attack. It's very clear you go home with two types of medications, you're going to do well. That's the standard of care. Less than 55% of people get that going home. We as physicians know that, yet still we don't do that. Part of that is this whole process of incorporating what is known into practice. So this point about using big data has to become a practice. A tool is much easier to pick up and start doing than telling you what to do as practice. So I think there's that balance between understanding that a tool which is in many ways standardized like it is around radiographic images can be much easier to look at and go, I can use this, as opposed to me telling you, how do I use data when I'm rallying on a patient in the NICU? Right? Being able to do that, that's a whole different workflow and adoption around that.
But I have to say, some countries do healthcare better than the US. particularly countries that have very little resources. If you look at countries like Bangladesh, they actually have healthcare workers who are minimally trained, but they're good enough to go into homes and manage chronic disease. So we need to get into that mindset, not always this is a fast food, fast gratification kind of country that's focusing on quaternary care. We got to balance that with just basic health care. It involves people going into homes and find out what's going on rather than expecting technology to take care of the difference in the care.
Yeah, my other feeling, just to add to what the other two panelists have said, is that physicians... If you think of radiological data is much more deterministic. EKG data, much more deterministic. EMR data, 20% of it is coded incorrectly. So the in claims data, you've got a lot of guys who are who are delivering babies and things like that. So you've got a veracity problem in the data, and so there's a question that if you don't control the data and have good data management, good data stewardship, is what is this algorithm doing and what does it mean? And no doctor likes a black box, particularly they don't understand what the black box is doing. So it's the early stages, and there's a whole world of understanding around how do we manage and maintain data, build confidence in the infrastructure that we have, and then also understand what the data is telling us, because we've got to get physicians, these guys have already gone back. We've got to get people to understand what data means, and I mean in a way that is not the traditional way that they were trained around randomized double-blind prospective controlled clinical trial. But what can data tell you, and what does it not tell you? And so that the problem is you often see these sort of simple faults where people are thinking that correlation equals causation and all of this, this kind of stuff, looking at large patterns in large data, you're going to get correlations that mean nothing. And so, you know, it's numberful, but, you know, the veracity of the data, there's got to be solid for physicians to believe that when you scale that up, that you're actually getting insights that make sense. And then, you know, it's like if you've got a neural network doing a whole bunch of stuff and you have no idea what it's doing, you know, you're going to have up tens of thousands of people who are managed before they start to believe that the impact is trustworthy. And so it's just, you know, it's technology adoption, it's pragmatic concerns at the individual level.
That raised another question for me. So would the adoption be better if the technology was sold by medical device companies versus tech companies? Like, would the physicians embrace it more if GE sold it?
Listen, I will tell you, the question I was asked earlier about, you know, what is the best thing to come along? You look for tools that engage patients and get them to connect with their physicians and providers. Those are the things you want. I mean, if you were to create an Uber MD app, right? And I'm being serious.
Yeah.
That would bypass all the third parties and allow patients to directly connect with someone they trust. You'll go a long way to solving a lot of this.
We are out of time. You know, can we take one quick question, or should we? You guys.
Well, set the data.
Perhaps a comment and the final questions is, and coming back, I think, to the good things of all these big data.
Can you use the mic? We are recording.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
This needs to be the last question.
I want to really have a feedback in this one. Think about the good promise of all these big data. Perhaps we are really at the stage that finally we're going to have like a comprehensive picture of a person, and that really is going to be, I think, defined in the way we're going to be. To do the good things, right? Because for now, whatever thing you're doing in hospital, you have a snapshot of the person.
Right.
Now with the technologies, I think you can have a full picture, like a true picture of the person. And I think capturing the uncaptured data is going to be key in the future, and that's really the promise of all these big data we can move forward.
Well, one of our dream projects at Telehealth Orange County is day one. Do the Google baseline project where they're recording everything. Why, I mean, and looking against adults, I have adult patients too, but why wait until they're 40 or 50? Why not start on day one and map out their biomedical picture and future? And I think that has great promise. So I think that will get done by the end of the decade.
Yeah, and I, you know, I don't think it was a question, it was a statement. I mean, and I think we all agree with it. At least my belief is we all agree with it. What we were getting into is that, you know, 15 years ago or so, when the human genome was first sequenced, is that there's a lot of heavy lifting between there and figuring out how you do it. And I think that what we were talking about a little bit is what are the pragmatics of getting to that promised land, because the data is definitely there, and we all believe in the vision of it, and that's why we're here, and that's why we, you know, go to work every day. But I think there's just, you know, there's pragmatics around every layer of this that are going to take a while. But, and I like the idea of solving specific problems that actually improve patient care rather than trying to solve every problem.
Thank you, panelists. Thank you all for.
Well, what a lovely discussion. Well, this is another opportunity, I think, for those who stay for a little longer. Panelists will be here, and there's also a reception out there. On behalf of the Roger School of Business, and especially the Center for Digital Transformation, thanks for coming. We do have a few copies of the Human Face of Big Data. Please fill out the form. And the CDP staff will randomly select winners who they will be. Okay. Again, on December 8th, we have another wonderful event scheduled. Please sign up and join the further discussion, transforming healthcare. Thank you for coming. Thanks for the panelists again.